every one of you here. It's a very important day. It's not a good day. It's not a good celebration type of day. It's the day of a year ago when the Veteran Affairs Office in Sydney on George Street was closed. So we're just trying to emphasize the fact that we're not pleased with the fact that it is closed and that a number of other ones, 8 more, were closed across the country. And today is the day when we're trying to send a message to the government of Canada that we're not happy and that we want to make sure that these offices are reopened. I want to especially thank the veterans for showing up here this morning. Today is about the veterans. Today is about our struggle and our fight. They did a lot of fighting for us. We're trying to fight back for them. And I want to thank each and every one of them for showing up here this morning. We're talking about the situation with veterans who are both mentally and physically disabled, who are trying to get things done for themselves. And I want to give you an example of what that would be like. My father worked at the Sydney Steel Corporation for 44 years. He operated one of the biggest cranes in North America. He was the guy that poured the molten steel into the ingots and stuff. The steel, I think it was up something like 2,900 degrees Fahrenheit. And it was like hundreds of thousands of tons of molten steel. And he did this, and he was a very small man, and he did a good job. If you put him behind a computer, if you put a cell phone in his hand, if you put an iPod or an iPad in his hand, he would probably hyperventilate. And I don't say that to make fun of my father. I simply suggest to you that someone that's both physically and mentally challenged, some veterans that are having a problem with trying to deal with Veterans Affairs and not being able to speak to someone in person, can you just imagine the trouble that that would create? And can you just imagine how many times they want to just give up and quit? So I wanted to make that very clear. So that's where I'm coming from anyway.
In this room today with you, there's many men and women that put uniform on for us to protect our country. And there's some that are here that are still doing that. And I guess it's hard for us that never put a uniform on to really know what they went through. And it's something we should got to be proud of and always remember. Right now we have a sad moment, I guess. It's not only we're here commemorating the closing of the office, but there's also, we just hit a milestone where more people committed suicide from fighting in Afghanistan as fought in the battle, which tells you about it's how hard it is not to be out there, not only fighting for democracy, but how hard it is sometimes to come home. And I guess that's the main reason we need these offices open, to be there for men and women when they come home. Yeah, it's been a rough year. It's been a rough year, and it's not all been good on the veteran side. We've seen court cases that went through, and we've seen money that was sent back on the budget. But I think the biggest thing that stands out is the closing of these offices. And I thank everybody that's not only with the last year coming out, but coming out today. And Ron is here, and he was up in Ottawa with some veterans. And as many of you know, Justin has committed to reopening these offices. And I think we have to keep working on that and keep fighting. And your voice being out here today is heard right across Canada. And I commend you for it.
It's sad to think that, in this day and age, for this particular reason, people have to take to the streets, but that's what we're faced with. So congratulations and thank you for coming out today. We had a great week with Ron Clark was in Ottawa and with his two partners, Jerry Kovacs and Mike Blaze. They pounded on every door in Ottawa, made a strong case, a respectful case, a compelling case for the provision of services here in Sydney. Both Mark and I had an opportunity to ask the minister questions on Wednesday. The question I asked was, the way I framed it was very simple and straightforward. You know, instead of lecturing veterans, listen and learn. I mean, Ron Clark continues to still wrestle with his own demons of PTSD, but yet he fights for services for others. For the folks now that, the men and women that have to drive 6 hours up the road to Halifax to receive those services, or walk into a Service Canada cubicle and bare their souls to a Service Canada rep. And we're seeing that across the country. One colleague of mine said he received, in a half hour, he received 25 texts in a half hour period from a veteran who was having a real, real tough day and couldn't get access to the services. You know, I grew up in Glace Bay, and I know there's a crew from the Bay here today, and I had the two great families on either side of our house. We had the Hilliards below us, and we had the Kellaways above us. And Billy and Tom were both veterans. Billy served in the Navy. And when he came back, Billy handled it pretty good. Raised a great family and was a very productive member of the community. Tom came back. He was a coal miner. He was an Army vet. And he had seen some awful things in his time overseas. And every Saturday night, whether it was the liquor that brought the demons back or the demons forced him to get into the liquor, whatever it was, he relived that reality every weekend. We didn't know a lot about PTSD then. We didn't, you know, we could see the physical injuries. We didn't know about the mental and emotional injuries. And it was his strong and brave and courageous wife, Ruth, that was his major care provider. That was then. And there's probably some excuse we can, because we didn't know. But this is now. And we know the difference. And we know that if we expect young Canadians to serve our country, then when they return, we have to serve them. They tell you in politics, you know, if you got a good case, you pound the case. If you got a bad case, you pound the desk. Well, I'll tell you, this case is obvious. We will continue to pound the case for services here in Sydney. Thank you very much.
When I attended the Rally of Concern, I realized that January 31st, 2014 was indeed a decisive moment for Canadian veterans. So, with camera in hand, I went about documenting the gathering. I became inspired by the outpouring of support and felt compelled to lend a hand. What I want to show you are a few images from that rally and the preceding Veterans Day. As I became absorbed in these events, the following moments and emotions revealed themselves with stories of sacrifice,
sadness, concern, disgust, anger, among all those feelings, signs of hope appeared at the moments of defiance, pride, passion, determination, and family. During the preceding Veterans Day, we found moments of solemn reflection, perhaps of honor, and tradition. The next generation. So I have big shoes to fill. And of course, no less important are those men and women who followed a different path of service. The rally call of that day was answered with camaraderie. Support. A show of community. I will leave you with both the following quote from Cynthia Ozak. We often take for granted the very things that most deserve our gratitude. And a passage from the Cape Breton Post. Wittingly or unwittingly, Harper and company have picked a fight with an army of seasoned warriors who have earned special treatment, who are overwhelmingly supported by their fellow citizens, and who tend to espouse conservative values. They have picked a fight with the wrong bunch.
We're going to hear from a very special man next. Ron Clark joined the military in 1956. He spent 10 years with the Royal Highland Regiment, the Black Watch. And in 1966, he mustered to the postal trade. In the postal trade, he served in Vietnam, Cyprus, Africa, and he spent a total of 12 years in Germany. As a side note, he was inducted into the Canadian Boxing Hall of Fame, and he retired in 1992. Now today we gather to recognize the needs of our veterans and we have after they serve and the effects of those office closures, and we hope that decision makers will see the importance of reopening these offices, maybe even opening more. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like for you now to pay special attention to one of Canada's biggest and most fervent advocates for the veteran, Mr. Ron Clark.
Just a couple of minutes, and that is to thank the people who jumped in behind me while I was away and organized this setup for today. Vince Rigby, can I have a hand for Vince, please? And Blair MacIver. And Nina, where's Nita? I would like also to give a call out to PSAC. We have a president here from Ottawa today. They donated a bunch of money to purchase and put up that big picture of me down in the highway. And the last thing, we have t-shirts down the back for sale. The monies from those t-shirts is going to help to fight to keep these offices open. Any money that's left afterwards will be donated to veterans organizations that are in need. So thank you very much.
Gentlemen, we're very pleased this morning to be able to offer to you a gentleman who is going to represent the veterans. He's going to speak and say a few words. He joined the military over 30 years ago, 1981, December the 5th. He served in Germany in 84. He went to Gagetown, Wainwright, back to Gagetown. He was in Victoria in 88. He went to Cyprus for a couple of years. Back to Gagetown, over to Goose Bay for a couple of years, to Cornwallis and to Croatia. Gagetown slowed down, so he worked for the Cape Breton Highlanders. He then did a civilian-type job for Nova Scotia Power and retired in 2002 for medical reasons. Vince is now retired. He served overseas with the 3rd Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry and the 2nd Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure and honor to introduce to you a veteran, Mr. Vince Rigby.
I have PTSD due to my 22-year service with the military. During the time, I've served in Cyprus, Germany, Yugoslavia, and all over Canada. Veterans and their supporters are here to fight for our rights. We are not here to bash the government. We're here today to say it's been 1 year since our office has closed. The government has said there would be more accessibility to the programs. We have tried it. It's not working. The government promises that the services would not be affected, but this is not the case. With the office closed, we are forced to use the internet, phone service, and peer support groups. This is an example of what's happening when the veterans close the offices. Some soldiers with PTSD are put on hold, and then are passed from person to person, telling his or her story over and over. This makes them relive their own nightmare, thus causing more stress. By the end of the phone call, their soldier is so frustrated, the soldiers give up on the situation. They may even give up on life, as we well know. In most cases now, soldiers going through DVA have multiple problems. It's not just one issue, there's 10, 15. And some do not even know they're sick yet. What about our older veterans? Many of them don't know how to use the internet. Who's there for them? I have a hard time. I can't do the internet stuff. Phone services, they're too hard. They're difficult. With my own case, it took more than 9 years of stress on my family and fighting to where I am today. I am not the only one. And this was with a team here in Sydney of caseworkers with our office. I have used the new system and have been put on hold for more than 20 minutes at a time. And if I was told it was an emergency, call 911. I cannot imagine going through this process now with PTSD as a younger vet. We know now, we know that there's many great services within DVA. But with 9 office closures across Canada, the delivery system for Veterans Affairs Services is broken. Without an office, an appropriate staff and their services and benefits go unutilized. All the money the government has set aside for veterans, most veterans can't access the programs that the money is provided for. Most veterans don't even know what they're entitled to. Therefore, they go without. The one-on-one training staff has been there for years, built relationships with our veterans, skilled workers that have experience and knowledge of the new programs. They're gone. They're no longer with us. We need them back. There's also a trust that the persons over the phone cannot duplicate. Since these closures, we have tried other avenues to access help, and even they've tried to take that away from us. Now some of us have to depend on our support groups for information. But we are not trained to do the sensitive and delicate work, and we are not trained to navigate the complex world of the government bureaucracy. In closing, we have tried their way for 1 year now, and it's not working. No permanent caseworkers, no offices, 5-hour drives, well-meaning but inexperienced staff on the phone has to stop. The people we're calling, they're inexperienced. They don't know how to deal with us. They're just passing us on from person to person. The rate of suicide within veterans now is 1.5 times higher than the general population. There was a comment made that in Afghanistan we have more suicides here in Canada and Afghanistan. Actual fact is we have more suicides since the Korean War After the Korean War, every peace commission afterwards, we have more suicides now from there, from all these missions here in Canada than we do overseas. We need more access to programs, not less. I would like to also thank my caseworkers for all the times that I've made phone calls for my crisis. Without them, I would not be here today. Thank you very much.